It's my pleasure to introduce Guido. Guido is director de recherche au CNRS and is heading the Centre de RMN at Auchan in Lyon. Guido did his PhD on in Pise, lucky man, on methodological developments of lanthanides complex for circular dichroism and NMR. In 2002, he moved for a postdoc in Sweden in the group of Professor Hoting, where he studied metalloproteins protein by solution NMR and developed the use of paramagnetic ions for the structural determination of proteins. In 2004, he arrived in Lyon for a postdoc in the group of Professor Hemsley and switched to, if I can say, to biological solid-state NMR, and is integrated the CNRS in 2005, I guess. Since when he develops in his group new approaches to address the structure and the dynamic of proteins and large complex assemblies using fast MIS solid-state NMR. Among several distinctions and prizes, he got an ERC Constellator grant in 2014 for the structure of paramagnetic integral membrane metalloprotein by MIS NMR. Today, Guido will present a webinar entitled Fast Magic Angle Spinning NMR of Membrane Proteins. Thanks a lot, Guido, for accepting the invitation, and let's go.
Yes, let's go. So thanks, Olivier, for the invitation, first of all, and for the very kind introduction. So it's I regret not being able to be in Toulouse today. I would have really very much liked to visit your institute and the town, a town where I've never been so far in my life. But well, we'll do it at another time, at another
Yes, don't worry.
moment. So this is quite an experience because this happens to be my first seminar on a tablet, because we didn't manage to install properly the software. I didn't manage to install properly the software on my laptop. So let's see, we will discover the power of Mac technology for these webinars. In principle, it should work. So let's start broadcast. 3, 2, 1, it says 0. So now it's starting broadcasting, you should be able to see my start screen. Is it, can you confirm? I only see my screen now. I don't know if you are still there or not, if you
Yes,
can
I
hear me.
confirm it's
I hope.
perfectly
Okay.
good.
So let's it's a very weird, and for all of you who tried this webinar experience, it's a very weird situation to talk. I mean, to talk in front of a screen, hoping that the public follows on the other side. But so fast mass NMR, fast magic angle spinning NMR membrane proteins. So its title may sound to you a bit exoteric. What I'll try to demonstrate is that, I'll try to explain the latest developments of a very powerful technology and this magic angle spinning NMR, and try to demonstrate its impact into current structural biology for important samples as membrane proteins. So I don't need to introduce to you membrane proteins. So integral membrane proteins are central players in the functions, in many functions inside cells, and an unmet challenge for structural biologists, because all the techniques which are capable of atomic level investigation of these molecules are confronted with difficulties in producing large single crystals in the case of diffraction studies, difficulties in the case of solubilizing these molecule in at a small molecular weight for solution NMR, or the difficulty in producing sufficiently homogeneous samples at high resolution for cryo-EM. Nonetheless, the three techniques presented here have made impressive progress over the last years. But what I would like to show you today, that there is a fourth technique here that can provide unique insight in structure and dynamics and movements in these samples. This technique is solid-state NMR. So solid-state NMR is always cited as the little sister, the younger little sister of solution NMR. It's a younger and clumsy little sister. And in the field of solid-state NMR, actually, it's in the field of membrane protein, it's a technique which is famous maybe for producing very simple structures. What is a catalog that was produced in a review in 2014 by Ladislavsky, is one of the pioneers in the application of solid state NMR to membrane proteins. And the technique is always considered as a promising technique, but which, however, can tackle only very simple samples, but delivers only limited structure information out of very complex experiments, extremely long measurement times, and very large sample quantities, where several tens of milligrams of labeled, isotopically labeled proteins are required to get some information. So this is which places an amount in the background of the main characterization techniques in structural biology for many years, but still all the so everybody had to recognize from the very beginning a peculiar advantage of solid state NMR. Solid state NMR is capable of yielding this local structure and dynamical information on samples reconstituted in lipid bilayers. So already this demonstrates the fact, already this sort of carries an important advantage, because the samples like so proteoliposomes of 2D crystals, you can see them in, I don't know if the pointer works correctly, 2D crystals here, or are samples which are much closer to a native membrane. And therefore, sort of the potential of a technique that can give structure in this environment is highly valuable. What I would like to demonstrate you today, to show you today, is that with the most recent developments of NMR involving the highest magnetic field, the GigaHertz, actually GigaHertz was the highest the last year. This year we have, the community has seen the installation of the very first 1.2 gigahertz in Florence, in Utrecht, in Zurich, in Göttingen. But with the use of ultra high field and with the use of what we will discover, the fast magic angle spinning rotors. So these very small sample holders capable of very rapid movements inside the magnetic fields, is possible to get rapid structure determinations of large transmembrane proteins. I would like to guide you into the recent developments that have enabled this, have enabled the technique to stand where it is today, and to allow much proper and pertinent action in the field of membrane proteins. So what I would like to start is what the situation was 10, 15 years ago. Solution NMR on the left. Solution NMR, as you may, many of you may know, is a technique that requires about a milligram of sample in solution. So we have these tubes with sample holders. So you have here an example of a carbon nitrogen label, so isotopically enriched small proteins, GP1. And the key for NMR is this kind of spectrum. So it's a two-dimensional proton nitrogen correlation. This is the fingerprint spectrum, the so-called HSQC, so the basic solution NMR module, which allows to monitor for each signal, each amino acid. Every signal in the protein corresponds to a single NH pair, so a single amide pair, single amino acids, and all the protein sequences represented, apart from prolines, is represented in this chart, which is the key for determination of structures, but also assessing site-specifically binding or interactions. The solid-state NMR, and here I present the example of the same molecule in a crystalline form, requires traditionally much larger sample quantities, 10 to 20 milligrams, and performs the action in this magic, in this in a sample holder, that so the rotor that is tilted with respect to the magic to respect to the magnetic field by an angle which is the root of a particular function and allows to simplify the sort of magnetic crosstalks between nuclei and simplified spectrum. The equivalent solid state of the fingerprint spectrum are these carbon-carbon correlations. In this, traditionally in the solid, we interrogate carbon nuclei instead of proton nuclei and nitrogen nuclei. We will see that in a second. But this kind of spectroscopy is particularly sensitive, and the fingerprint spectrum requires about 1 to 2 days, and differently from the clarity of the solution counterpart is a spectrum which is quite complex to interpret in terms of structural meaning. Therefore, it's very difficult to follow from this spectrum structure changes or interactions in a protein. Why is we have this difference? Well, we have this difference between solution and solid state because because solution NMR is based on proton. Proton nuclei are protons are the nuclei with the highest geomagnetic ratio, which are therefore the nuclei where NMR has the largest signal. Carbons have a much smaller geomagnetic ratio, and the associated signal is much smaller. So, but why can't we do solid state NMR on the protons, on the proton nuclei, which are the ones which would give higher sensitivity? Well, we can't because protons in solids, because of a very large geomagnetic ratio, talk very loudly between each other in a solid sample. And if the sample doesn't rotate doesn't tumble freely in solution, these strong crosstalks between nuclear spins produce a very tight network of internuclear communications, which in turn turns the spectrum into a very broad, almost featureless signal. So it's very difficult to reconstruct atomic level properties of a molecule out of this spectrum. On the other hand, the carbon nuclei, because of a smaller geomagnetic ratio, provide under magic angle spinning, under the rotation of the sample, provide very high resolution. So solid state NMR was forced to sacrifice sensitivity for resolution. If you want to have many resolved signals and therefore site-specific information, we need to give up sensitivity, which explains why we need to study structure of complex molecules, we need weeks or months of experimental time, years of data analysis, and even longer periods for the evaluation of structures. Now, what happens if we try to do proton detection, if we try to detect the proton nuclei, the high sensitivity nuclei in the solid? This is what we get. So we don't get a resolved fingerprint, a proton nitrogen correlation, but if we try to record the proton spectrum in the conventional setup for magic angle spinning, we get a very broad and featureless blob. And blobology is actually the nickname of solid state NMR in structural biology. So the art of reading, like in the bottom of the coffee powder, reading some meaningful information out of a very, very information rich, they say, pattern. Now, is there a way to solve this problem? The community has worked on that for many years. The proton detection, the objective of resolved proton detection has been the objective of strong research within the community for the last 20 years. So Griffin, Pioneer, McDermott, Kurt Thielm, Bernd Reif, so many groups, but suggested, well, if a problem is got the idea. If a problem is the very dense network between protons in a sample, what we can do, we can remove the protons, we can deuterate the sample. So if we deuterate the sample, and then Rife, Hoshkinet added something more, and we reprotonate the sample only with a partial backprotonation, then we have a sample where there are no protons, and actually protons are only few 5, 10, 15% of the exchangeable groups, the amides and the NH2 at the NH3 at the end of the chain. So this so it's a strategy that can be applied to membrane protein, and you can see on the bottom the resolved proton nitrogen correlation spectra that you can get on a beta barrel compared with equivalent spectrum proton nitrogen correlation that you would get from the same molecule in solution. This is on the right, there is an example of another molecule with alpha helical, high alpha helical content. So it is possible to recover resolution also for solid samples in lipid bilayers. But what's happening here? If you remove the protons and you limit the presence of protons to 5% of the sites of in the molecule, finally you are sacrificing again sensitivity in order to get resolution. So finally, in order to acquire this kind of spectra, you need tens of hours, almost days. So finally, again, you haven't solved the problem of conjugating sensitivity and resolution. You would like to move to protons because of a promise of high sensitivity, and finally you get very long and sensitive correlations that require days to acquire, so countering the purpose. So there is another solution, which is to reduce the rotor size and spin the sample, the rotor faster. So by miniaturizing the apparatus, you can increase the spinning speed, and by increasing the rotation around the magic angle, you improve the averaging of this proton-proton deleterious crosstalks, and you increase potentially the quality of the spectrum. But about 10 years ago, 10 years ago, Bruker developed this small 1.3 millimeter rotor, which therefore had great potential to this respect, which was capable of accelerating the rotation to 60 kilohertz. Now, 60 kilohertz, or 60,000 rotation per second, this is something extremely high speed. It's mind-boggling. So imagine this is 1 second, and the object has produced 60,000 rotation in that second. Is something extremely mind-boggling. But there were a lot of perplexities in the community. Well, if you reduce the sample volume in order to spin fast, in order to accelerate, you need to have a smaller rotor because the edge shouldn't move faster than the speed of sound for stability problems. So if you want to have an higher angular frequency, you need to reduce the rotor size. If you reduce the rotor size, you reduce the sample quantities that you can place inside the rotor. If you reduce the sample quantities, you reduce sensitivity. And if you reduce sensitivity, you are turning to protons for higher sensitivity, and you reduce the sensitivity by reducing the sample quantity. So this is impossible to win in this situation. So this should be a dead end. Should be a dead end. And actually, in the community, we had realized in 2014, was almost well, not 7 years ago, but actually, you can mix the two approaches. If you use deuterated molecules, where 100% of your amide sites are reprotonated, and you use the fast spinning of 60 kilohertz mass, you can achieve two-dimensional fingerprints on a variety of immobilized substrates, microcrystalline proteins, sedimented capsids, and membrane proteins in lipid bilayers with high resolution and sensitivity. So these correlations are reasonably resolved, although they don't match their solution counterparts, but they only require about 10 minutes to accumulate, to record. And therefore, carry an immense promise in accelerating the structural biology connected to solid state NMR. Now, if you have this information is very pertinent in the study of membrane proteins, and the first examples we had back in 2015 was for the example, the analysis by proton nitrogen correlations, so of the analysis of the backbone, but also the nitrogen proton of the side chains, so for example, tryptophans of histidines at the core of, we studied this influenza A, the N2 dimer of dimers, so proton channel. By the analysis of the network of proton-proton contacts at the core of this molecule, we could clarify the proton conduction mechanism in this drug-resistant mutation. So it's interesting, you can do a lot of things there. And also on a deuterated sample, we developed a collaboration, there was a very nice collaboration we developed with the group of Olivier Sorel and Alain Milon in 2017, where we looked at Klebsiella pneumoniae on A in lipid bilayers, and they characterized the movement of this molecule and the different flexibilities of loops and the movement, the residual tumbling of the barrel in the lipid membrane preparation. So this is interesting biochemical characterization of membrane samples, but it's not exactly a full routine determination of structures. And actually, if you have a deuterated molecule, it's very difficult to turn a deuterated molecule into a structure. So this is an example of a collaboration with Art Motoshkin, another of the pioneers of the field of membrane proteins by solid state NMR. And this illustrates the process of structure determination of OMP G. So it's a beta barrel in lipid bilayers. This is a molecule that Armut provided with nitrogen labeling, carbon labeling, and deuteration, so in a deuterated form. And structural determination in solid state NMR requires evaluating pairwise proximities between pairs of nuclei. And we use sophisticated proton detective experiments to evaluate the contacts between different pairs of residues. And however, in order to, in a deuterated molecule, there are not so many protons left. And if you want to evaluate distances between pairs of protons, actually the proton-proton contacts that you can find in a deuterated samples are not enough. You need to supplement, in order to get a full fold determination, you need to supplement these proton-proton contacts with many carbon-carbon contacts between all the carbons of the backbone and the side chains, which then you need to acquire with a traditional carbon-detected, therefore insensitive, routines. And in order to get the structure, to achieve the structure of these particular molecules, we had to record tens, or Hartmut rather, or actually a PhD student of Hartmut, the poor Johann Sebastian Rettel, had to acquire tens of spectra with extremely long acquisition times. So this is quite a complicated approach. And actually, there is also another drawback in the study of the application of deuteration to the study of membrane proteins. And this is the big contradiction that Vlad Ladjansky raised 10 years ago. Is that if you look at a sample, this is protorhodopsin, that you can look at in very fast millimeter rotor, in a deuterated form, you cannot, if you produce this molecule in a deuterated environment, by exchanging the molecule in protons. You cannot reintroduce protons in all the sites, but you can only selectively reintroduce protons in the regions of the protein that undergo exchange, therefore partial local unfolding, so some of the loops, and only portion of the transmembrane helices which are in contact with water once the molecule is folded in lipid bilayers. As you can see from the snake plot here, this corresponds to a very limited portion of the molecule. So most of the molecule, the transmembrane part, which is the core of the molecule, the potentially interesting part of the molecule here, the part of the molecule which is in contact with the retinal cofactor, for example, is invisible to NMR spectroscopy. So we're not really there. So two problems. We don't have enough protons to determine the structure, and we don't have enough protons at the core of the molecule for deuterated molecules. So two drawbacks that we can solve, but the community has solved. We have a benchmark, the first pioneering experiments in Lyon through a collaboration with Bruker, with the use of even faster magic angle spin rates. So in 2015-2016, the Bruker has been able to, was finally convinced by our preliminary results that it is worth to invest in the miniaturization of the spinning speed, and to produce even smaller rotors capable this time to spin almost 220 kilohertz, so double than the 60 kilohertz previously available. So in this case, what we could show is that, and that's a milestone PNAS paper by Lauren Andrea, is that the highly resolved proton spectrum can be acquired on proteins without the need of deuteration. So the meaningless blob that one typically acquires under traditional conditions with large rotors and slow spinning can turn into high sensitivity and surprisingly high resolution. So the amazing thing is here is that we turn the initial blob into an highly resolved two-dimensional fingerprint without sacrificing sensitivity. So we can still achieve these 2D correlations in 10 minutes by reducing, so despite the fact that we reduce the sample to half a milligram. So half a milligram of a sample now in 10 minutes are sufficient to yield a fingerprint, a snapshot of a protein in different aggregation states. So this is a game changer, and also because associated with very fast magic angle spinning, here I'm talking to the most to people who are more informed about NMR spectroscopy. There is a particular properties. Not only the resolution increases, so lines, the line wave go down with spinning speed, but there is also a second property, so the coherence lifetime that increases with spinning speed. Now, in solution, these lifetimes, coherence lifetimes, are very, very, very short for large molecules, and they represent the main bottleneck for the investigation of large molecules. What we can show here, but in solid, the coherence lifetime, which is connected to the efficiency of any multidimensional NMR experiments, increases independently on the molecular size of a molecule, meaning that high sensitivity in multiple experiments is possible for different molecules of different size and different aggregation state without the need of deuteration. So the field has turned into 10 years from the original carbon detected approach, so where people were looking at carbons only at low sensitivity, therefore slow spinning, large sample volumes required, into a full protonation at fast magic angle spinning and small sample quantities. This has dramatic implications for structural biology. So just you can see an example of how faster spinning impacts resolution in the case of a membrane protein. So moving out of model systems, you can see that 60 kilohertz in a fully progenitive membrane proteins do not provide any site-specific resolution for most of the signals, while many more signals start to be resolved at under kilohertz. Now, these are spectra at low field. This is a 500, and if you increase the field from 500 to the gigahertz, you can reduce the experimental time and increase significantly and amazingly the site resolution. Therefore, large membrane proteins in lipid bilayers are accessible, become accessible at sites, with site specificity with a new approach. Now, more broadly, this positions solid-state NMR into well, at the same level of the main characterization techniques like crystallography or cryo-electrospectroscopy. So, this already configures a particular role for solid-state NMR in the context of crystalline samples. So, in the case of, well, you may say, okay, if I can crystallize the sample, why should I bother doing solid-state NMR? I would do the diffraction. Yes, you can do diffraction, provided the sample yields a large single crystal. Now, if the sample yields only small crystals or nanocrystals or a crystalline powder, like it is very often the case during the crystallization trials, well, solid-state NMR is suitable. And actually, this example here, these are data from Martin et Thielme back in 2003, showed actually that the NMR quality doesn't have any difference whether you are looking for polycrystalline samples with large samples or nanocrystalline samples in a diffracting powder. So the resolution of NMR is only affected by local environment, local order, not global order. Therefore, also, nanocrystalline powder are extremely suitable for high-resolution NMR investigation. And for example, for this class of sample, a way to produce a preparation suitable for solid-state NMR is to precipitate, to have very large batch precipitation in a tube or in a pipette tip of a molecule, then centrifuge this preparation into the NMR rotor by using particular centrifugation tools where the rotor is contained here. There is a funnel here. All this tool is placed in an ultra centrifuge, which uses the centrifugal force to fill the rotor. And once the rotor is filled and closed, we can place it at the magic angle in the man in inside the magnetic field and perform NMR. Now, just a parenthesis outside the field of membrane proteins about the utility of performing solid-state NMR on crystalline protein. There are two examples. One is the Linzer group from 2019, and one is our group in 2020, that show that two very well-known enzymes, human carbonic anhydrase, human copper zinc superoxide dismutase, that are extremely well characterized by X-ray crystallography and many other techniques, that are very well-defined structures, which were supposed to be very rigid, actually contain a wealth of internal dynamics, which is connected to function, to the catalytic activity of the zinc ion in the human carbonic anhydrase, and also to the role of copper ion in zinc superoxide dismutase. These are counterintuitive demonstrations, but actually by studying hydrated crystals, one can really achieve a lot of insight in meaningful internal dynamics, which is often overlooked even by solution NMR studies, where the most important dynamical or important motion, but actually determines the feature of the NMR spectrum, is the tumbling of a molecule, which is very informative with respect to the function of the molecule. Now, another class of molecule, just to mention the big fields, big areas of application of solid state NMR, you may have imagined, is amyloid fibers, so these long insoluble aggregates. This is an example from 2021, collaboration with a group of Antoine Loquet, Birgit Abenstein in Bordeaux, where we help them to, with fast magic angle spinning, to transform these two-dimensional fingerprints, here an example of proton carbon fingerprint of the molecule, into the structure, the high resolution structure of this aggregate. Another area of targets, another class of targets, but is particularly intriguing for analysis in solid state NMR, are large molecular weight proteins or protein assemblies or protein nucleic acid complexes. So these are typically targets but unsuitable for high level, high resolution investigation by solution NMR, because due to their, to their size, these molecules have solution NMR lines which are out of which are do not convey interesting information. Now, all these molecules, because of their size, can be solidified by centrifugation. So if you place these molecules into an ultracentrifuge with a rotor at the end, the molecules are taken, are spun out, are sedimented out of solution by the centrifugal force of the ultracentrifuge, and yield a rotor full of a paste, which is sufficiently mobilized to get a nice signal in solid state NMR investigation. That was an intuition by the late Ivano Bertini in 2011. But today provides a routine way to prepare samples of large globular proteins, capsids, assemblies, and protein RNA complexes. These are examples that they present here out of a collaboration with the group of Tatiana Polenova, Teresa Carlomagno, Martin Blackledge, and the Florence group. But then let's go back to our initial focus. The main area of most promising, flourishing area of application of this new technology is the field of membrane proteins in lipid bilayers. And here there are three examples where this technique of proton detected data have contributed with an increasing weight in the determination, full determination of protein structure. So the Influenza A collaboration with Bob Griffin and Lauren Andreas in 2015, where protein detection provided few data at the core of the molecule in a deuterated sample. OMG determination in collaboration with Hartmut Oshkinat, where again proton detection was used in an integrated way together with data from carbon detection, and the alkyl molecule that we determined in 2020, which is the first example of a full determination based on proton detected solid state NMR. I would like to, in the following, to spend a little bit more time to show how this the process of determination of alkyl worked in detail. So you can see on the bottom here the way the sample is prepared. We have a solution of a membrane protein in detergents. By dialysis, which exchange detergent with lipids, the membrane protein precipitates, and this precipitate can be centrifuged into the NMR rotor and studied under magic angle spinning. Parenthesis, before going to the specific application of alkyl, the possibility of studying membrane proteins in with full deuteration solves also the one of the issues that we mentioned earlier. If we now apply the magic angle spinning on the sample of proteoredopsin, the same sample where we had incomplete exchange in the early examples, and we apply under kilohertz magic angle spinning on a sample which in this case is fully protonated, we can get a signal, the blue spectrum, which has reports on the full part, the full molecule, and is not limited, like in the previous, in the red case, to the exchangeable portions, so the water exposed portions of the molecule. Therefore, we can have a much deeper insight into functionally important areas of the protein. Now, we are talking about, I would like to show you an example in the very last few minutes, an example of how the structural determination by solid state MR can be streamlined, but we talked about high magnetic field, we talked about fast magical spinning. There is also another component in the successful completion of a structural determination is the people. And Loren Andreas, Tobias Schubeis, Greg Guillemarchand, Jan Stanek, Diane Kala, Andrea Bertarello, Daniela Lalli, Marta Bonaccorsi, been outstanding members of my group who have performed, who have really realized this big progress of solid state NMR. Now, specifically, I'll illustrate the structural determination of this alkyl, so the alkane hydroxylase system of Pseudomonas putida. So, a system involved, a system that sits in the outer membrane protein and that is responsible for the transport of small organic molecules inside the outer membrane, across the outer membrane, in particular across the lipopolysaccharide layer of the outer membrane. Now, there were some homologs with crystal structures, there were some homologs with solution MR structures, but the details of the transport and the mechanism of transport were largely debated. So this project that we started developing within my ERC project actually was at the interface through our access facility of two users from Munich, Tom Schwarz and Catherine Castiglione, and was a project largely promoted by Loren Andreas when still he was a postdoc in our group, and then was also carried out in parallel while he was he became PI at MPI, and while at MPI involved in the project there the Groot and his group for computation for computational studies of this enzyme. So how does the study a characterization by solid state MR works? You need to overexpress the molecule. In this case we could try E. coli with large yields in labeled minimal medium. We added, or Tom Schwarz had a protocol for purifying in detergent and reconstitute. We tried reconstitution in lipids, so this slow dialysis, detergent out, lipids in order to get liposomes, which were centrifuged into the rotor to allow NMR. Actually, the first use of NMR and of these proton nitrogen two dimensional correlations was what we employed was to optimize the sample reconstitution. So there are a number of parameters in the sample reconstitution, the nature of the lipid and the protein to lipid ratio that needs to be adjusted experimentally. So we use the quality of the NMR spectra as a parameter for screening the sample reconstitution. We try the PHPC first. The sample is spectrum is not so nice, and when we try the nice lipid, the MPC, the spectrum becomes much more richer in resolved signals, sign that the protein has a much more proper appropriate stable folding in this configuration. Once the correct lipid is found, we move to screening protein to lipid ratio, and we try to increase the protein to lipid ratio till when the spectrum, well, still has no changes with respect to the previous conditions. And as soon as we increase protein concentration even further, the spectrum degrades, giving the sign of improper aggregation, and therefore, telling us that the proteins are not fully embedded in a lipid environment. Once we find the correct conditions with a nice lipid and high protein to lipid ratio, we can move to faster mass, higher field, and you can see a nice resolved two-dimensional spectrum. Now, once you have resolved two-dimensional spectrum, you can proceed like in solution NMR. You can use these two-dimensional fingerprints to monitor proximities between protons, so to monitor pairwise distances between nuclei and feed with this information some simulated annealing protocols that fold the molecule. So it's a cyclic iterative process that folds the molecule. So here summarized is the four steps that we perform. The first one is the backbone resonance assignment. So we need to tell which resonance is which, and for which we use number of established proton detected amide and H alpha triple resonance in our experiments. But we developed for fast magic angular spinning on the ground, so the solution experience of smaller molecules, smaller soluble molecules. We have other experiments that tell us which resonance is which, also for the protons in the side chains, for the carbons in the side chains. Then we measure these pairwise contacts that yield a three-dimensional structure. And here, this is the result. Well, the result is that you can see on the left the structure that one would determine from the same molecule in solution if you deuterate the molecule and in detergents. And on the right, you have a molecule that you see lipid bilayers by solid state NMR. So you can see that the transmembrane portion of the molecule, this beta barrel, is identical in the two cases. But the conformation of the long loops, which appear as very disordered, highly dynamical by solution and in detergents, actually in the solid represent fold a very well defined and precise geometry that carries some information about the function of the molecule. And in the very last few slides, I will show that actually the information hidden in this portion of the molecule that was invisible in solution studies and other solution studies carries the key for understanding the function of this molecule. So if you look closer at the molecule, you see a transmembrane part, which has so the canonical hydrophobicity for a membrane protein, hydrophobic portion outside, hydrophilic portions inside. But the extension of this beta barrel outside the membrane has the opposite polarity. The hydrophilic part is on the outside, hydrophobic on the inside. But this makes sense because this is a part in contact with the lipopolysaccharide layer. But what's weird is that the molecule, it's a pore, but the pore radius is larger than the water molecule, so it's sufficient to carry the organic molecule, the substrates, on the top of this extension, but then becomes very narrow, in particular at the center of the molecule. So if not even the water molecule can flow through the molecule, how can the substrate go through the molecule? So the pore here is closed. Now, to solve this information, we can use another property of solid-state NMR, a property of NMR, which is the capacity to sample motion of different in different windows, from very fast motion to picosecond motions, from meti rotation, for example, up to very slow motions in the seconds range. And there are a number of techniques that transform the signals observed by solid-state NMR into observables connected to these motions in the different areas. You can either look at how some properties like anisotropy of the spins, spin interaction can be scaled down by motion, or we can also check how motion modulates the magnetic interactions and promotes relaxation, spin relaxation, given reporters on specific time scales. This is the nitrogen and carbon T1 or nitrogen carbon nitrogen T1 raw rates. So we can have specific experiments to probe selectively motions in particular time scales. And in particular, if we go back to our alkane transporter, we can see that there are residues surrounding a large side opening here that seem to be affected by microsecond, millisecond motion. And if we look at the molecule and we add now a substrate, for example, carvon, which is one of the small organic molecules that is transported across the membrane by the protein, we see chemical shift changes before modification exactly around these, the very same residues here. So what we seem to see is that motion may have a role in producing making the dilation or opening of a side of a side exit, and therefore may be responsible to transport for transporting the molecule into the membrane from the side instead but across the membrane. And then we teamed up by Bert de Groot and his group that through the setup of very sophisticated MD simulations, he could actually show that the molecule indeed undergoes a deformation of this upper part. And exactly where NMR can probe the larger relaxation rates, there is a big displacement that opens the pore sideways and allows molecules of substrate to diffuse laterally into the membrane. This changes, therefore, the interpretation of the phenomenon. Alkali is not a molecule that allows molecules to go through the outer membrane, but simply that uses dynamic to capture molecules outside the lipopolysaccharide layers and get them across the lipopolysaccharide layers into the membrane, from which they diffuse spontaneously into the periplasm. So this is a nice example we published in the PNAS last year, but demonstrates that structure and dynamics at atomic level provided by solid NMR give a new powerful insight about the function of the molecule. I thank you, the people of the group, the Sierra Men, Lauren Andreas and his group at MPI, Bert de Groot, Catherine Castiglione, Tom Schwartz, Bob Griffin, Art Motoshkin, Tatiana Polenova, Brad Schmelka, Vipin Agarwal, international collaborators in the different continents, and Bruker BioSpins, and many of the people who funded this research. And I would like to thank you for kindly listening. Hello? I cannot.
I forgot
Hello?
to turn on
Ah, yeah,
the microphone.
okay.
Thanks a lot, Guido, for this nice presentation, this good overview of biological solid-state NMR and how you and others overcome the different limits during the last decade. Okay, if there are any questions? Okay, so Andrew. So Andrew, I'm going to try to. Where are you, Andrew? Okay, so yes, but I don't see. Okay, Françoise, j'ai du mal à. Ah, c'est okay. Sorry. Okay, Andrew.
Okay. Hi, Guido. This
Hi.
is fantastic. I really enjoyed this.
Thanks.
I learned a lot. I have a couple of questions. I mean, as you say, these spinning speeds are now, they really are mind-boggling. 110,000, 110 kilohertz is, it's sort of outrageous. Does this create any mechanical stress either on the sample at the level, either macroscopically or at the level of the membrane or the protein itself that needs to be taken into account? Or is this then reduced when you go to such small scale?
So we were worried about that, but actually we and the community has been worried about that already from the time of from the large rotors and the smaller speeds. So already in the so for the canonical 10 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz or 10, 20 kilohertz rotations with large rotors with large diameters, this produces important accelerations in the sample. Actually, what we notice is that with the smaller rotors, the perturbation of the sample is smaller. Well, perturbation of the sample is connected to the centrifugal force, but also to to the diameter. For example, in the newer setup with smaller rotors, we have much less frictionality because of the smaller radius, and in the end we don't see any alteration to the sample. So this has been tested, but so far extensively. But in the current setup, we don't see any perturbation in the way the sample is contracted, so the protein to lipid contacts.
Mm-hmm. If I could ask one more, in your alkyl, in the structures you showed in solution, you see the extra the part that isn't transmembrane as being highly disordered. Is that actually disordered, or it's a lack of restraints that the structure is there, but the motion relative to the membrane transmembrane part is not defined?
Well, we have both actually. For some of the loops, well, I didn't go to that level of details, but that's a very important question. We have both. So we have, for some of the loops, we don't see anything proving that the motion is on a particular time scale, but bleaches out the signal, so we don't have information. For some of the loops, we do have information, and the loops are random coil, so are completely disordered, which would indicate a partial destruction of the structure due to the presence of detergents. So detergents have an organic portion that would interact with the organic with the organic the non-polar inside surface of this outer of this outer beta barrel, and would therefore likely perturb it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have a question of Lionel. So Lionel, you are allowed to talk. Okay, Lionel. Maybe he doesn't hear me. So okay, so I will read the comment for the chat. Lionel said, "Very nice talk, thank you." Two questions. First, would be there any use of solid state NMR for disordered macrocrystals, like those that do not diffract well, or even not at all? First question.
Yeah, so that is would be an extremely useful and pertinent application of solid state NMR. That indeed, yes, the answer is yes, because so NMR would be able to prove whether the absence of diffraction is due to static disorder or to the presence of dynamics happening at room temperature inside the crystal. And in the latter case, NMR would provide both the structure and the characterization of the dynamics, the time scale, and the amplitude of the motion. So yes, that's an area that where NMR hasn't, solid state NMR hasn't been tried, but is slowly approaching with the first demonstration experiments on large hydrated microcrystals. So yes, that's okay. A great idea, and would be also a class of sample on which we could try to do something. So I had actually, maybe, can I show a couple of slides more? I would like to advertise one aspect of our facility that, Olivier, that you know very, very well, but so this is our laboratory in Lyon. So this is spectrometer hall, office, and lab space here. This is the spectrometer hall with the different staff and the different different spectrometers. So large collection of spectrometers. We have grants, but what I wanted to say is that we are part of this IRRMN network. This is a network, a French network for high field and mass spectrometers, co-funded by the CNRS and the Institute of Chemistry of the CNRS. In Lyon, together with the other sites. So we are part of a network. In Lyon, we are we provide access on three of our high-field spectrometers, the GigaHertz, the 800 wide-bore, the 800 narrow-bore. So there is a mechanism. So not only we provide access to the three spectrometers, but also to a large number of probes we have here and the connected expertise. And there is a well-established protocol. So if you look at this website, errmn.fr, we have also the equivalent for European users at the European level to submit a project. A project can be a very concise description of the context of the given protein, given molecule, and of the experience you would need. But often the users call us to ask about, to ask advice to write, to sketch these kind of applications. And very rapidly, at the longest is within a month, typically within a month, you get access to 1 or 2 weeks of high field NMR projects in our facility, and also access to the associated expertise. So this is to say that so for any ideas, we will be happy to support you with more experimental times and try some of your ideas in this context.
Okay, thank you, Guido. Lionel had a second question. So second question about loop stabilization when compared to liquid NMR. Could it be considered as artifactual, the same criticism as for crystallography? And more generally, is there any impact on spinning sample at such as rate on atomic properties?
So I start from the end. There might be an impact on the spinning of the sample at such a rate. We have checked that. So we can check that with carbon fingerprints at different spinning speeds. They don't change. And this proves that the structure is not altered, at least up to the conditions used today. And actually, the largest source of perturbation of the spectrum is the frictional heating or the heating connected to the strong RF irradiation, but only happens in these large rotors spinning slowly, and is not necessary anymore in the more modern approaches. So the sample integrity, I think we are quite confident within our lab and within the community more in general. About the loop stabilization as compared to liquid NMR, one may wonder whether that's an artifact. Actually, the structure is the same, so the artifact may come from the high density of, so the artifact you are mentioning here may come from the high density of proteins in the preparation. Now, the structure, the fingerprint of the molecules don't change whether the molecule is diluted, so with different protein to lipid ratio in the preparation. So this proves that the structural features are consistent with, are not an artifact. We have tested the molecule and this fingerprint in a sample with the LPS, and also in that case, the spectrum is not different. And most importantly, the molecular dynamics simulation show that this extension is stable when the molecule is subject to free movement in a lipid bilayer. And actually, the only movement to which this portion is subject is not a global unfolding, but is this local opening of the side of the side exit, which is consistent with our interpretation. So all this points out to the fact that this additional structure invisible before is a real element, I would say.
So Julien Marcou has also commented. So I'm reading Julien. Very nice talk. You mentioned large protein assemblies. Can you tell us a bit more about NA or approximative size limit?
Yeah. So size limit is very fascinating. There's a lot of debate now in the community about this. So of course there are two problems connected to the size. One is the larger the size, traditionally, in solution, the larger the size, the broader becomes the signal, and therefore the more difficult it is to interpret them. And the second point is the larger the size of a molecule, the more of the signal you have in the spectrum, therefore the higher overlap. So this has so the double effect on resolution and sensitivity. Now, by solid state NMR, we don't the quality of the line is independent from molecular weight. So the molecular weight of the molecule can be infinite. Now, what cannot be infinite today, unfortunately, is the complexity of the spectrum. So the number of signals that you can fit into the spectrum. So multimers are the ideal samples for solid state NMR. And for example, the first determination we had on a fully protonated molecule in 2016 was a 2.5 megadalton capsid, which had 180 copies of the same molecule of only 12 kilodalton. So that's an ideal case. As for the sample complexity, there is a lot of debate today how to increase it. So can we have monomers of larger size? So in Jack's paper this year, we demonstrated early last year, we demonstrated that we can get with about 10 days of experimental time and automatic acquisition and data analysis, we could assign the MVP. So it's a 40 kilodalton protein, the maltose binding protein, a fully protonated form. So molecules which are out of reach for solution NMR, but and can be rapidly assigned by solid NMR. Now, to tackle the frontiers, these frontiers is an ongoing development, but we can think that with faster spinning, higher magnetic fields, smarter maybe isotopic labeling, we would be able to access molecules of twice that size, 100 kilodalton and beyond.
Okay, and maybe I guess it was a microcrystalline sample. And what about membrane protein? Because in membrane protein, the signal looks broader than a...
Well, so membrane protein signals are not necessarily broader, or not always broader. Or if they are, signals may be broader, but the coherence lifetime, so the capacity of the signal to resist several... the multiple steps of necessary to build the hyperdimensional, multidimensional experiments can be very long. The problem, one of the problems of membrane proteins is that we need to have in the rotors also the lipids. So we need to have the protein, but also the lipids. So the concentration of intrinsic protein quantities in the samples are reduced with respect to a microcrystalline protein. So a microcrystalline protein, we can fill the rotor of it. So we can have 0.5 milligrams of sample, which correspond to 0.5 milligrams of protein. In the case of a membrane protein, half of that weight is lipids. So the protein is only 0.25. Which therefore has an intrinsic limitation in terms of sensibility. This is a sensitivity we would need for four times as much time, experimental time to acquire the same signal to noise.
Okay, I have also a question about a technical question about coherence lifetime. So you mentioned that the coherence lifetimes was higher, at higher angular spinning speed. But what about the magnetic field on the coherence lifetime? It is also higher?
Yeah, it has an impact. So the magnetic fields make the separation between the proton frequencies. The proton couplings are very annoying because protons have typically the very same frequency. The chemical shift difference between nearby protons is very small, and therefore protons talk to each other very, very, very efficiently. So if we could prevent protons from talking to each other, the spectrum would look better and the coherence lifetime would be long. So this is what fast magnetic and spin does, but this is also what magnetic field does. So if magnetic field was going 100 times higher, the proton frequency would differ very largely between nearby protons. A proton wouldn't be able to talk to each other so rapidly. And this would result in a dramatic improvement of the spectrum. So of course we cannot move that fast in the magnetic fields, but if we could access 1.5 gigahertz in the next 10 years, that would be a dramatic more than linear effect in the resolution of this spectroscopy.
Thank you. So I have a question of Martin Gilleron. Very comprehensive talk. Thank you. Are there other transporters which have been analyzed by solid-state NMR at 1 gigahertz?
Well, yeah. Well, we have a class of molecules we are looking at now. Magnesium, bacterial magnesium transporter. I showed you some of the spectra. We have a very well developed now vision of how the structures that is conventionally produced by X-ray, so the static visions by X-ray or by cryo-EM, actually needs to be modified to take into account dynamics in a lipid bilayers. And so with this transport of magnesium ions, but one transport, and we have several studies on different different versions of aquaporins. So where we can we try to highlight the role of dynamics in the water transport across the membrane, and but we would be willing to try so other applications. So despite the immense methodological advances, the field hasn't fully yet incorporated the many samples that the community can produce and would like to study. And I think that the one of the objectives of this European networks of access provision like iNext or of the ERRMN in France is exactly to bring these new methodologies closer to the community of the potential users, to the chemists and biochemists, who maybe or biologists who maybe interested, but maybe know little about NMR, but would have important important applications for the technique.
Question from Pascal Demange. Thank you, Guido, for this nice talk. Did you try to determine the structure of ALK-B in membrane from E. coli in the native environment?
Yeah, no, this is an exercise we haven't done for ALK-B. But where we are trying, we are trying this on other membrane proteins here in the laboratory, and indeed the use of native membranes, so reconstituting with native, so not, but yes, reconstituting the molecule and using lipids extracted from native membranes, for example, already gives a large improvement in the quality of the spectrum, showing that for many samples, the nature of the lipid, the nature of membrane, and the presence of other constituents in of a native membranes have a key role for protein correct folding and the protein happiness, so the correct briefing of a molecule, the correct dynamics. So this is an extremely important application area, and we would be very interested to look at more in detail to rationalize these aspects with on new samples if necessary.
Yeah. I have also a question. So you showed that the loops were disordered in detergents, while they are ordered in membrane. How do you explain that? And did you try to reconstitute the protein in nanodisc to analyze it by the liquid state NMR?
Yeah, so this is a very, very interesting point. So yes, the first part of the question, detergents, as I tried to say before, our explanation is that detergent interferes with the portion with the hydrophobic inside of the funnel of this extension, and interfere exactly in the way that a polar substrate would do for being transported, and perturbs and partially destroys the outside. The outside structure. So this is sort of expected or can be plausible given the role of this molecule. Now about the reconstitution of the molecule in none of these, we have given few attempts, and we have never successfully, we will never be able to successfully reconstitute or sort of obtain a preparation that conserves also the structure, preserves the structure of that portion in solution. But maybe we're not so good in this kind of preparation. but this is also one of the direct advantages of solid state NMR, that finally the preparation is, I don't say trivial, but the reconstitution is happens by simple dialysis, while the alternative approach for solutions of the nano discs has a higher complexity, and also for larger targets, then increases the molecular size of the molecule, and therefore affects in the end sensitivity again and resolution and solution of mass studies.
Okay. Thank you. So there's no more questions. So again, I think that we will close this session unless someone would ask a question. No, it's okay. So thank you. Thank you again, Guido, for this nice talk. And see you later, maybe.
Yes. So I'm really looking forward. So thanks again, and looking forward to see you, Olivier, and you all also, hopefully soon. To see you to court at the end of this coronavirus thing, and also for hopefully interesting scientific exchanges and beyond in the future. Thanks again a lot.
Okay, thank you, and goodbye.